Amen. Let's all stand. Welcome to church this Sunday morning. If you would, don't forget, get your phones out. Let's share the live feed from today so that we can be a blessing to those around us. Facebook is quite the tool here in America and around the world. So let's be a help out to our local family and friends and share the feed for church this morning. When the roll is called up yonder on the first, sing it out, ready?
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
We're singing about your name in heaven, amen. If you're saved, your name's been written down. And let's sing about that this morning on the second. Ready?
On that bright and cloudless morning when the dead in Christ shall and the morning of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the sky, the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Welcome to church this morning. We're glad you're all here and hope you've had a good week. Our ushers have some bulletins there in the back. And if you slipped in without getting a church bulletin, this might help you keep up with announcements and things. And you can keep up with all the scheduled things for this week. Would you raise your hand and let them come and serve you with one? If you did not get a bulletin, just slip up your hand there. Good to see visitors here with us today. We're glad all of you in the house of God with us today. We're looking forward to seeing what the Lord might do for us this morning. And pray for a preacher, as him and my mother are out of town this week. They went to Tennessee to see my uncle and aunt there. And so pray that they'll have a safe journey back. If you've had any kind of special needs, you can always let us know, and we'll put you on our church prayer list. Thank the Lord for what God is doing. Right back over here, Brother Jason, there's one hand over here as well. But I hope you've had a good week, and we're into our finished our second week of school here at Calvary. So the school year's got off to a good start. Pray for a lot of the kids in our county. I think in Clay County, most of the schools start on the 25th. So a lot of the kids will be going back this week, and then Duval started last week, I think. But we're glad all of you are here. Let's pray for our services this morning. And as soon as we're finished with our prayer, I think we got a special number. Let's pray. Lord, we love you, and we're thankful for the opportunity to come out to your house on a Sunday morning. We're thankful, Lord, for the good grace of God you provided for us this week. Thank you, Jesus, for our members and their lives and what you're doing in their own personal lives. Thank you for the victories this week that we've seen, the ones that have even been saved the last several days. And we do pray that, Lord, you would bless the morning service, would use the singing and the fellowship, the preaching, all that we do to glorify your name. And then, Father, I pray if there's anybody in our midst today that's not yet born again, may today they come to Christ as their Savior. And we'll be careful to praise you for what you're going to do in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin.
Thank you for that, choir. Let's all stand once again. Trust and obey. There's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Let's all stand. We'll sing on the first together. Here we go. Let's raise our voices.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. His good will, He abides with us still. Who will trust and obey? Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
On the second,
not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey.
Here we go, ready?
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
All right, now parents, sing it like you're talking to your kids, okay? Sing it like you're talking to your kids. Trust me and obey me. How much more our Heavenly Father, you think, feels the same way with our being children of God? Amen. Trust and obey Him. Let's sing that third. Ready?
Then in fellowship sweet, sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Fear only, trust and obey. Trust and obey. No other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
As the piano continues, turn around and greet someone this morning. Tell them you're excited about being in church. Alrighty, as we make our way back to our seats, let's sing through "What a Mighty God We Serve" on the screen. Let's all stand. What a mighty God. Ready?
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him, heaven and earth adore. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him, heaven and earth adore. What a mighty God.
One more time, ready?
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him, heaven and earth adore Him. What a mighty God we serve.
Great singing. You may be seated.
All right. Thank you for being here again this morning. And ushers, you have visitors cards there in the back. If you're visiting with us for the first time at Calvary, or it might be the first time in a long time, we have just a visitor's card that we'd like you to fill out so we can keep a record of your coming with us this morning, and we're glad all of you are here. You raise your hand up real high and let us come and serve you with a visitor's card if this is your first time or first time in a long, long time to be here at Calvary. Would you raise your hand real high and let us come by and serve you? Good to see you. I had a young man that rode the Sunday school bus with me this morning, Bronson, from up in Buffalo, New York area. He's here. And then back over here, Brother Ralph and his family's here, and over on this side. All right. Good to see all of you here. If you'll look inside your bulletin just for a moment, we'll make a few announcements. Our nursery workers are needed for our nursery department. If you're interested at all in being a helper, a worker in our nursery department, see Miss Jen, and there's a sign-up sheet on the back table concerning that. Also pray for our fellas as they go down to the Clay County Jail every Friday to do ministry there. And if you'd like to be on that schedule, see Brother Weaver here about that. There's a training time that they do, I think, later in the year for that. And then let's see, next Sunday evening, it's our fifth Sunday of the month, so we're having our dinner next door in the Rager Hall for the evening service. And we'll have dinner, and then if you need to bring some things, see Miss Joy Weaver about what you could bring to help with that. And there's a sign-up list for that. And then also we'll have preaching over there. As I said, preacher's gone tonight and today. And so tonight, Brother Brent Gullo is going to preach our evening service. So we'll be excited about hearing from him. And then we'll also have a guest with us tonight, Brother Louis Brasino. Brother Brasino was with us several months ago, but the reason he's coming to be with us is just to share a testimony. We're going to share a video of the work there. But next Sunday morning down in Miami Lakes, he's starting a church there. And they're going to be starting inside of a hotel banquet room, and it's a new church. And so preacher, even though he's gone this weekend, wanted us tonight to vote to try to add him onto our missionary list of missionaries that we support. Most of our missionaries, you see these flags hanging up here, these are countries we've been to with the ANOM ministry. But on a monthly basis, Calvary supports about 85 or 89 missionaries. Most of those are foreign missionaries and church planters. But there's a need in America, especially in our urban areas, to start new churches. And there's a lot of churches over my lifetime that have closed down and are no more in existence. And so Brother Brasino will be here tonight. He'll be sharing about the work there and what they're planning on doing. And so be back for our evening service at 6 o'clock. And then the Sweetheart Couples Class is having an activity next Saturday. Is that right, Brother Sherman, next Saturday? Or this coming Saturday at 4 p.m., and that will be from 4 to 7. It's going to be meeting at Brother Josh and Miss Savannah's house. The Eccles house here has the address there, and that's for anyone that's a couple here at our church who would like to come out to be that. Brother Sherman, would you mind even coming and praying for our offering? Maybe you want to say a word as well about that. And then I just put a note in here. The Eccles are helping us restart our Reformers Unanimous program. They're doing some training right now and getting the materials ready, but the startup date for that is Friday night, October the 9th, I believe is the date of that. Is that right? The 9th, I think it is. And so that's a program that's designed to help people that have any form of addictions. It's just a good in-depth Bible study material that they use. And so if you have folks or you yourself have need of that program, that will be meeting on Fridays, and it will start up on October the 9th. And thank the Lord for the Eccles family being being willing to help us restart that ministry. And then on the 6th and the 13th of September, which is coming up a couple of weeks, on those two Sunday mornings, we're having what we call Register to Vote Sunday, Civic Sunday. And if you're not yet registered, we'll have some things here at the back that you just take you a few moments, and Miss Melissa help us with that. But you can become registered to vote so that you as a Christian can vote in the upcoming election in November, all right? And let's see, I think that's all the announcements. Thank you all for being here this morning. Make sure you make visitors feel welcome for being here. This is a good number of folks here with us this morning. We thank the Lord for you being here. And Brother Sherman, come. If you want to say something about the couples class meeting, you can do that and then lead us in prayer for the offering.
Amen. Yes. So the address should be in the bulletin, and also calvarycares.net. If you go on there, there should be the address there. We want all the couples to come. Hey, man, we want the police called on us. And no, I'm just joking. Laugh, people. Come on now. And thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. But no, if you're a couple, we want you to come, and we're going to have a good time. And then, of course, when Sunday school starts again, we want all the couples come to our class as well. Don't worry about your other Sunday school teacher. I'm trying to start a church myself, so I'm just, no, but, but no, we just, we love having a good time. We miss our class, and as of course, I'm sure that every single Sunday school teacher does. We cannot wait till Sunday school starts again. Hope that you guys come, and we'll have all have a good time there. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can be here today, this morning. Thank you that for Calvary Baptist Church. Thank you for all the people that are here today and the visitors. Lord, I pray that you would bless each and every aspect of this service. And Father, I pray that you bless the singing, the preaching, the tithing, especially the invitation time. I pray that, Holy Spirit, you speak to all of our hearts. Help us to change our lives for the better. Change something and go out different than when we came in. Father, I pray that you would bless. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for that, Brother Weaver. Let's stand one more time, and we'll sing the last song, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. All together on the first, let angels prostrate fall. Singing, you may be seated.
I was drifting away on life's pitiless sea, and the angry waves threatened my ruin to be. When away at my side, there I dimly descried a stately old vessel, and loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy, ship ahoy!" And loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy!" 'Twas the old ship of Zion, the sailing along. All aboard her seemed glorious. I heard their sweet song, and the captain's kind ear, ever ready to hear, caught my wail of distress as I cried out in fear. Ship ahoy, ship ahoy, as I cried out in fear, ship ahoy. The good captain commanded a boat to be lowered, and with tender compassion he took me on board. And I'm happy today, all my sins washed away in the blood of my Savior, and now I can say, bless the Lord, bless the Lord, and now I can say, bless the Lord. O soul sinking down 'neath sin's merciless wave, the strong arm of our captain is mighty to save. So trust him today and no longer delay. Board the old ship of Zion and shout on your way. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout and sing on your way. Jesus saves.
Will you take your Bibles to the book of Psalm 150? Psalm 150. Wasn't that a great song? I mean, Brother Matt's not much to look at, but that was a good song right there. Brother Matt was a teenager in our church many years ago, and probably 30 years ago was a bus worker with me on my bus route in Orange Park. And so he's been a part of our church, he and his family now, wife and two boys, for many, many years. The book of Psalm 150. When you find your place there, would you stand for in reverence to the Word of God? It is good to see all of you here this morning, and we're looking forward to being back tonight and seeing Brother Brasino, and then also hearing from Brother Gullo the sermon this evening. And so tonight, this morning, out of Psalm 150, we're just going to read one verse of Scripture, verse number 6, and we're going to read it in unison, and then I'm going to pray. Now, I wanted to also mention this morning in my prayer, and I meant to during announcement time, Brother Jim is having surgery on his shoulder, on his rotator cuff, on Tuesday this week. So during our prayer this morning, we'll pray for him and keep him in prayer on Tuesday morning, okay? And they mentioned that to me during the handshaking time, and I want to make sure as a church we do that this morning. The book of Psalm 150, and look at verse number 6, a familiar verse, all right? Verse number 6, we'll read it two times through, okay? Verse number 6, let's read together, ready? Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Let's read it again. Some of y'all still don't have your Bible out, okay? So we'll try it one more time. Verse number 6, ready? Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. praise ye the Lord. And tonight, this morning, I want to talk to you on this subject, inside the curio cabinet. Now, that title may not seem like it meshes with the sermon and with the scripture I read to you just a moment ago, but y'all that have little china cabinets and curio cabinets and things at your house, you put things that are of value inside that case. And over next door in the school, we have a trophy cabinet. And we put the trophies our kids have won at the school inside that case. And we put them on display. And the message this morning is about you and I as children of God putting the Lord at the center and making sure He's the one we talk about, making sure He's the one we praise. It's easy in life to start thinking it's all about us. The Bible says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. That means these young men on the front row over here, in their life every week, they need to have time where they praise the Lord. Doesn't matter how old you are. Everything that hath breath. That means an unsaved man is supposed to praise the Lord. He's got breath. Everything that hath breath, praise the Lord, Bible says. And God deserves our praise. And we ought to make sure that we're putting the attention on Him in our life and not we ourselves. And I want to talk to you on that subject this morning inside the curio cabinet. Would you bow your head for prayer? And would we ask the Lord to help us this morning? Now, Father, we're so grateful that you brought us out to the house of God this morning. We know this is just a building. These are just pews and just a wooden pulpit. But Lord, you brought us here to meet with you. You brought us here to talk about you. You brought us here to celebrate you. Lord, I pray that this message this morning would not be about anything eloquent I can say. It wouldn't be about anything that we could draw attention to our church or to ourselves. Lord, we know you love each of us. And Lord, each of us have a great value. But Lord, if we come and all it's about us and about what we're doing and about our church, then it's in vain. Lord, may everything that we speak about this morning glorify you, Jesus. And at the end of the day, when we go home, I pray if there's anybody here not saved today, they'll trust Christ as their Savior. And then I pray that in our own lives, we'll center our joy and our affection, our love, our commitment around our Savior. May you be the one that we lift up this morning. And we'll praise you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Now, would you flip back just to Psalm 148 as well? I want to read to you these verses of Scripture because I think they're of great value. At our house, my wife's family, they donated some years back to us a little china cabinet. And over a period of time, we began to put things. It has a light in it that you can plug in. It shines down into the casement. And we began to put things in there that were meaningful to us. We have in that cabinet, I'm sure, some pictures of our family. We've got things that her grandfather has given down to the great-grandfather, to the next generation, things out of their house that were in there. I was in Arkansas in 2014. And I was up in this little place called Altus where my father was born. And me and my father went to where the log cabin used to sit, where his brother, my Uncle Roy, where he began to listen to the radio one night and hear about J. Harold Smith coming to preach in Clarksville. And that log cabin had been demolished there, but the well was still out front. And in the back of it was another house. And we walked around this cow pasture to an abandoned house where some of the neighbors had lived. It had been abandoned for many, many years. Me and my dad crawled up under the crawl space in that little cellar. You know, those houses in the South sometimes will have those underground cellars. And we tiptoed around, and you know how you can find these old bottles and things, these old plates and stuff that date back 50 and 60 and 70 and 80 years. We found some of those, and I've got those at my house inside that curio. And probably some of y'all have those things. Some of y'all might be like my mother over at their house. She has a china cabinet, has all these little fancy potteries and stuff that she's collected over the years. But we put things that are of value in there. And the Bible says that we ought to delight in drawing attention to Jesus. Our praise ought to be for Him. In the book of Psalm 148, look there with me into verse number 1. The Bible says, praise ye the Lord. This is Psalm 148, verse 1. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him in the heights. Look at verse 2. Praise ye Him, all His angels. Praise ye Him, all His host. That means that up in heaven there are angels. Gabriel and Michael, thousands of angels, and God wants those angels to praise him. Verse 3, he says, praise ye him, sun and moon. Praise him, all ye stars of light. That means someone said there's 100 billion stars in our galaxy. Stars like Orion and the Big Dipper and the Little Dipper constellation. And God says, I want all of them to praise me. In verse number 4, he says, praise ye heavens of heavens, ye and ye waters that be above the heavens. That means everything in the atmosphere. God wants everything in the atmosphere to praise him. That means everything in outer space. And then what the Bible calls the third heaven, that's the abode of God. God wants everything that breathes to praise the Lord. In verse 5, he says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. Verse 6, he hath also established them forever and ever. He hath made a decree which shall not pass. Verse 7, praise the Lord from the earth, ye dragons. Brother John, we were talking about dragons the other day. Ye dragons in all deeps. That means God wants the whales to praise him, the sharks to praise him, the octopus to praise him, all those things in the ocean, the flounder. How many of y'all like to fish? You catch that fish, Jason, you like to fish a little bit? You catch that fish on the end of the string. God wants that fish to praise him. I guess while you're sitting at the dinner table frying him, he wants the flounder and the grouper and the mackerel and the marlin and the swordfish and the dolphin and the tuna and the carp. They say there's 28,000 different types of fish living in the ocean. God says, I want every one of them to praise me. Then he says in verse 8, the fire and hail, snow and vapors, stormy winds. Aren't these unusual verses? And fulfilling his word. That means he wants the lightning to praise him. He wants the hailstone and the blizzards that they don't have in Florida. He wants the tornadoes, the hurricanes, the typhoons, the thunderstorm. Boy, we've had rain lately. God says, I want it all to praise me. By the way, he deserves it because he made it. If you're the creator, you can choose what to do with it. In verse number 9, he says, I want the mountains and all the hills, the fruitful trees and all the cedars. That means the trees down in South Florida, the orange groves. God wants them to praise him. That means Mount Everest, Mount Kilimanjaro in East Africa, the Himalayas, the Alps, Mount Denali here in America, Mount Washington, Mount Rushmore, the largest hill in Florida. You know where that's at? 184 feet high. They call it a mountain, Mount Dora. That, he said the hills also. That little hill coming up Long Bay Road. They call that the hump by the dump, you know. God says, I want that hump to praise me. Verse number 10, he says, the beast and all the cattle, the creeping things and the flying fowl. That means the lions and the elephants and the zebras and the monkeys. That means in Florida, those little lizards you got crawling around your house. And the toad frogs and the tree frogs and all those Middleburg dogs. Lord have mercy, there's a lot of dogs in Middleburg. I think there's probably, Brother Derek, more dogs than human beings in Middleburg. That means God wants those rabbits that roam around Clay County and the raccoons getting in your trash. Those horses and chickens and ducks and geese. Good night. I run a bus route to Collins Road, Orange Park, and there must be 50 geese in that one trailer park. I mean, you about have to slow down every time you go in that trailer park. God says, I want the geese to praise me. I want the redbirds and the robins and the owls to praise me. Now, pray tell, listen. If God wants all these creatures to praise him, don't you think he wants you to? Verse 11, he says, the kings of the earth and all people and princes and all judges of the earth. That means he wants President Trump to praise him. He wants the Queen of England to praise him. He wants the Prime Minister of Israel, Netanyahu, to praise him. He wants the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia to praise him. That means he wants our governor, DeSantis, in Florida to praise him. That means he wants all the residents of Jacksonville to praise him. And all those that live in Green Cove and in Stark and in Palatka and in Orange Park and in Ocala and in Keystone and in Middleburg and in Maxville. He says he wants the judges to praise him. That's Angela Cox down here, Judge Cox in Green Cove Springs at the county courthouse. Clarence Thomas at the Supreme Court. He wants Chief Justice Robert John Roberts, that traitor, to praise him. He wants all those that have breath to praise him, he says. And then he says in verse number 12, read it with me. Both young men, maidens, old men, and children. That means he wants every teenager at Calvary Baptist Church to praise him. He wants everyone in the nursery and in the toddler department and in junior church. He wants all y'all that are 60 uppers to praise him. He wants those of you that are married men and women to praise him. He wants the divorced folks of our church to praise him. He wants every young adult to praise him. God deserves our praise, and he deserves it this morning. He don't want you coming to church and looking at the preacher while he's up here like a calf looking at a new gate. He don't want you sitting out there while we're singing songs and you're just mumbling words. No, the Lord of everybody in the whole universe, the Lord deserves our praise. In verse 13, he says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name is alone is excellent. His glory is above the earth and the heavens. In the book of Psalm 22, you don't have to turn there, but the Bible says in verse 3, but thou art holy, O thou, that inhabitest the praise of Israel. Now, what does that mean? God says the person that's praising the Lord, God's going to live there. God's going to dwell with that person that praises him. Psalm 22:3. That means that the person that doesn't praise the Lord, you might be saved, but don't expect God to dwell with you. Don't expect God to go about you with the day and bless your life. God says, I'm going to bless those. I'm going to inhabit those that praise me. What's that word inhabit mean? It means to dwell, to abide. I don't know about you, but I want God abiding in my family. I don't know about you, but I want God abiding in the pews of Calvary Baptist Church. I don't know about you, but I want God's presence to be here in Middleburg. I want God's presence to be upon my children. I want God's presence to be in my marriage. I want God's presence to be upon my grandchildren. I want the Lord to dwell with me, but God says, I inhabit those that praise me. Amen. You ought to learn to praise the Lord. What does that word praise mean? I want to give you three ideas about what it means. You can have other ideas if you want to. You can probably add to it. But if you go back and study that word praise in the Strong Concordance and in your Bible study, it means, number one, to shine upon. So God says, I want you as a church member to shine upon me. I want you that are a child of God to shine upon me. What shining upon has the idea of drawing attention. My wife and I, we probably four days a week, maybe 3 days a week sometimes, but we get out and we walk in the morning time just to get our exercise. And then you'd probably laugh at me, but I come back to the house and I do jump ropes. Y'all know how to do jump rope? I do 100 jump ropes in the morning. And I don't catch my foot either. If I weren't good at it, I'd be falling on my nose, because we get out there and do it at 5:45 in the morning. That's when we go for our walk. And while we're walking up down the road, 5:45, we live out here off 218. And it's dark out there still at 5:45. Sun hadn't fully come up, and so I have a flashlight that I set on top of our kitchen counter. I grab that flashlight so that when we're walking down the road, a car, someone's headed for work, we're doing like that. Don't run me over, please, you know. I want to draw attention using that flashlight. God says, listen, God says, just like some of y'all in your backyard have those floodlights that shine over the backyard, maybe you turn those on at night because they're for security. Or maybe you're looking for something and you get your flashlight and you shine it around on the ground at night. God says when it comes to praise, you and I are supposed to shine attention on him. The Bible says, listen to this. The Bible says we're the light of the world. We live in a day of darkness, my friend. We live in a society where people don't know God. And God's looking for some child of God who'll not point people to the baptistry, but point them to Jesus. You understand what I mean? Not point attention to yourself. Hey, look at me. Look what I'm doing. No, point attention to Jesus. Amen. That we're to shine. The Bible says in Matthew 5 and verse 14, ye are the light of the world. A city that's set on a hillside cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto them that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. God wants unsaved people to look at you and not say, hey, I see Tim Simmer. No, God wants them to look at Tim Simmer and say, I see Jesus in me. I see Jesus in him. God wants people to know that there's truth, that the gospel is the power of God into salvation, and it's your job and my job to make sure that we shine attention on the Son of God. Don't draw attention to yourself. I love this church, but don't draw attention to this church. Don't draw attention to your culture. Don't draw attention to your education or your talent or your personality. Don't draw attention to a set of religious rites or formalities or sacraments or a church creed. Don't draw attention to some saint that died years before or an Old Testament saint, but let Jesus be spoken about. What's wrong in our society with churches that have contemporary music and praise and worship teams is often, not always, but often, it draws attention to self. That's right. I said to a brother this week as we're sitting down fellowshipping together, he said, I like the traditional hymns that Calvary Baptist sings. And I do too. And there's always a new song coming out, and there's nothing wrong with new songs. But let every song that we sing at Calvary Baptist or in our lives point people to Jesus. Don't get up front and draw attention to how smooth your voice is, how wonderful you look while you're singing. Draw attention to Jesus. Let the light shine on Jesus. What's wrong with stained glass windows with pictures of the Virgin Mary? What's wrong with them? What's wrong with statues of church fathers and saints being in the church house? What's wrong with them? They draw attention to the wrong person. You understand what I mean? Listen, Mary was a good woman. She was favored, highly favored, the Bible says. But as soon as you start putting a statue of Mary up here, there's somebody going to come pray to that. And my prayer as a lost man has to be only to Jesus Christ. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Thank God for church fathers and those that went before us and these pictures that line the wall and what they've done to teach us things from the scriptures, these men of faith. And the Bible says we're supposed to remember them and we're supposed to honor them. But let the attention, the light of our life shine not towards a man, but to the Son of God. And let people know He's the only way of heaven. While we honor godly men that have contributed to our lives and to the gospel, we should always remember that Jesus deserves our praise for anything good in our lives. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse number 6 says, for God, who hath commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. In John chapter 12 and verse number 32, Jesus said, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Make sure on our bus routes we're lifting up Jesus. Make sure when you go preach at the prison, you lift up Jesus. Make sure when you're witnessing to your neighbor, you lift up Jesus. Make sure when you try to talk to your mom about the gospel, you lift up Jesus. You can say, oh, I have such a wonderful pastor up there at Calvary Baptist. But don't let the conversation revolve around a preacher. Let the conversation revolve around Jesus. He deserves our praise. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Shine the gospel on him. Shine the light of the gospel on him. Number two, what's that word mean? Write this word down if you have space there to write. The word praise means to boast in. To boast in. It means to speak excessively about. Now, let's see. Brother Aaron and Miss Jen are here, I guess, this morning. And they're going to have a new little baby come November. Guess what you're going to hear about? About 150 times a week. You'll probably have to look at this picture and this selfie. Because people, when they have new babies, they like to talk about them, don't they? Guess what? Grandpas like to talk about them too. So you're going to be hearing a lot. I mean, you probably just need to stay home all the month of November. Because you'll probably hear it from them. You'll hear it from me. You'll probably hear it from their great-grandfather, you know. But the reality is when we're proud of our children, we like to talk about them. You like to carry on about them. To almost an excess to everybody else. But the truth is, it's because you love them. Now listen, If you love Jesus, you're supposed to talk about Him. You're supposed to boast in what He's doing for you. There ought to be people down at your job place that hear you talking about Jesus. There ought to be people in your household, not just here at church when you're putting on a good face. You know, that's what we do. We come to church and we make sure our ties just right. We put our Bible up underneath our arm. Boy, we're spiritual on Sunday morning. I've always thought it funny when you go to someone's house. You can kind of see that look on their face when it's just happened. They've been inside giving their kids the what for. I tell you, you better clean up that room before I beat the living devil out of you. The doorbell rings, they open it, it's the preacher. God bless you, Pastor. We're glad you're here to see us today. Come on in. Here's the kids. Say hello to the pastor. You know what? God was at your address before the preacher showed up. He knows how we talk in private and in public. And when we come to church, it ought to be about Him. But when we go home to our wife, it ought to be about Jesus. The conversation of our lips ought to... I'm not saying don't ever talk about sports or don't ever talk about mechanics or fishing or whatever things you like to do. I'm saying that people that know you ought to hear you boasting in Jesus. Ought to hear you talking about the Lord and what He's done for you. There was an old-time Nazarene preacher, lived many years ago. I think died in the 1940s maybe. But his name, they called him Uncle Bud Robinson. Uncle Bud, Brother Spencer, is from Tennessee. He is from a family of 13 children. When he was just a teenage boy, his dad died. And Bud Robinson moved to Texas with his mom. She wanted to start over and took all the small children with her and moved to Texas. He got to helping out as a teenage boy as a rancher on one of the farms there. And poor family. I mean, those days, he was born, I think, in 1860 or something like that. And in those days, poverty was ripe in the South. And so he one day a Methodist preacher came by and tried to witness to him. He wasn't ready to get saved, didn't want to have nothing to do with salvation. As a teenager, was fully involved in drinking and carousing and stealing and all kinds of nonsense. And that preacher said to him one day, as he's a circuit riding preacher in those days, he said to him, I'm gonna stop here and pray for you. And he said he started praying for him. And he prayed so loud, he said probably a quarter mile away, you could hear that Methodist preacher praying for him. He prayed and prayed and prayed, and he had just enough respect for the man's calling that he wouldn't walk away. But he prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and then as the man walked away, he started singing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. The preacher did. He didn't get saved. Bud didn't get saved. But as he walked away, he heard that singing of that preacher, Amazing Grace. Well, a month passed or so, and he was living up on the side of one of those places in Texas, and there's a little church down in the valley. And he said one night he heard in the dark some singing, and it was that same preacher's voice coming from a local church. And he walked down there off the little hillside and went to that church, and he sat in that church, and he said while he's sitting in that church of an old Methodist church that a dear saint lady of God came up to him and looked him in the eyeball. He's sitting in the back row, and she said, as only little old Southern women can do, she said, "Are you a sinner?" Now, how's that your introduction to the gospel or to the church? And she got down on her knees in front of him while he's sitting on that little bench and began to pray during the church service for him. And prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. Finally, the invitation came and the preacher was done preaching, and the invitation came and Bud Robinson walked forward and trusted Jesus as his Savior. Never had a formal education, didn't know how to read, never spent a day in school. His Sunday school teacher at that little Methodist church taught him how to read the Bible. The night that he was saved, he went back at about midnight to his place, and he didn't get all the way home, and he stopped underneath a little wagon, and he laid down, put his head on his hat and rock, and he slept under that wagon. And Bud Robinson said, this is from the late 1800s, said, Jesus appeared to me that night and called me to preach. Didn't know how to read the Bible, had no formal education, didn't know anything about the Scripture, but the night he got saved at midnight, God called him to preach, he said. And he went around preaching the gospel without any knowledge, hardly, of the Scriptures until he learned how to read. And he began to preach all over the South and throughout the western part of America. They called him Uncle Bud Robinson, and he had a lisp. So when he talked, he couldn't talk. He stuttered, and he had a lisp. And he'd talk about, if you read any of his old stories, he'd talk about the second blessing. And he believed that if you wanted to really be filled with the Holy Spirit and have God's power on you, you need to get the second blessing. And he said one day he laid out in the cornfield prostrated in the cornfield at night for 3 hours. And he said that night, laying in the cornfield, the Holy Spirit of God fell upon him. And now when he would preach the gospel, people by the droves would come to hear and be saved. Uncle Bud said when he'd go to bed at night, he'd pray this prayer, "Oh Lord, give me a backbone as big as a saw log and ribs like the sleepers under the church floor. Put iron shoes on me and a galvanized breeches, and give me a rhinoceros hide for skin, and hang a wagon load of determination up in the gable ends of my soul, and help me to sign the contract to fight the devil as long as I've got a fist, and bite him as long as I've got a tooth, and then gum him till I die. All this I ask in Jesus' name, amen." Bud Robinson didn't know much of the scriptures, but what he did know is he knew how to praise the Lord. And you and I that are children of God ought to be ashamed that we'll allow people that don't even know God to have more joy than a child of God has. We ought to praise the Lord. We ought to boast in our God. Psalm 107, verse number 2 says, "Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy." And then lastly, and I'll finish with this one, number 3. I said, number 1, to praise the Lord means to shine something upon or to draw attention. Number 2, to boast or to speak excessively about. And then number 3, to celebrate. And when you study the scriptures, there's even 2 or 3 times as you're coming across different passages where the word praise means to act the fool. Now, some of y'all do that really good. Here's what you do. You go to a wedding. Maybe the day you got married. You're celebrating. You're happy. So you do things that you would normally not do. Like feed each other a piece of cake at the reception. You know how dumb that looks? But if I went up and down these pews right now, half of you did it. And that got smeared. I remember you doing it, Miss Jan. I remember that. You smeared all. Listen, the reality is when you're happy about something, you'll do things you wouldn't normally do. Listen to me. And when you're happy about Jesus, it'll motivate you to do stuff that other people think, that's crazy. I mean, think about a wedding. You're going to go to a wedding and you're going to take a bouquet of flowers and throw it up over your shoulders. You know how silly that looks? All these little wannabe brides running around and do like this. I mean, the truth is you're used to it. But if a Martian came down and landed on our planet and showed up at a wedding, they said, "What in the world are they doing here? Sticking cake all over someone's face." Here's what you do. Before the bride and the groom take off the parking lot, some little rascal's going to sneak out to his car. You had this happen to you? And he's going to put shaving cream or whipped cream or whatever that is, shoe polish, all over. He's going to write stuff on the window. They're going to go in back of the bumper and tie a bunch of cans like they did in the old days. Tie a bunch of things on the back to make that car sound. And it's going to say, "Just married." You know why they're doing all that crazy nonsense? Because they're happy. They're celebrating. Now, my friend, if you can be excited about someone getting married, surely you can be excited about not going to hell. Okay, all right. Change it from the wedding. You're going to go down and watch the Jaguars play. Waste of money, somebody said. Unless you got corporate tickets, right? So you're going to go down and watch the Jaguars play. Now, just forget there's a football game going on. Take your video recorder or your iPhone or whatever, and just scan the crowd when something good happens. Just keep it on. Keep your camera on the end zone area and find you about a 350-pound redneck. And just keep that camera on him. You know what he's going to do? This guy that if he went outside and met you at the gas station wouldn't even look at you. Are you listening to me? He's going to get down there what's that guy's name? Fournay, is that his name? Fournay is going to run into the end zone with a touchdown. And that 350-pound fella from Clay Hill, he's going to start jumping up. Woo! Woo! The truth is, he's probably showing up at the game without his shirt on. And he's got a big J on his big old belly. Now, that guy's crazy. He's acting the fool. And listen to me. And he'll do that about something temporal, and you won't say amen while the preacher's preaching. Man, that was good. I'm going to have to say that one again. Whew, I hope Brother Tim makes that another point right there so these fellas on the front row will wake up. He's going to go down to a football field after a little round piece of leather, and the Jaguars are going to have a losing season. It's not he's celebrating the Super Bowl winners. He's celebrating the last place team in the division. And yet, they're going to get beat 41 or 42 to 7 because they don't got offense on the Jaguar team. Never. And yet, when they score that singular touchdown, he's going to get up and high-five strangers. He's going to spill his beer all over people. He's going to run around and shout. He's going to go home all afternoon and tell his wife what happened. And yet, I don't have to go to hell. You understand what I'm saying? I got something better than a touchdown in the end zone. My sins are all forgiven. Woo! I might take my shirt off. No, I won't do that. Put a big J for Jesus on my chest. No. God blesses you, and you never give God any praise. And you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Every good gift, every perfect gift from above. God gives you a church to come to and the Bible to read and freedom in America, and we complain. And God, the Bible says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. You know why young men will sit on a front row and not get excited about going to church? Because they're watching the 40-year-old not get excited. And they're watching the 50-year-old not get excited. And they're watching the 60-year-old. And blessed be God, if I can be excited about a little football or basketball or baseball, I'm going to get double excited about Jesus. Someone will walk an aisle and get saved, like Brother Joe last Sunday morning, a 91-year-old man get saved, trust Jesus as his Savior, come forward, someone share the gospel with him, and you and I ought to be excited about that. But some of y'all, while people are getting saved at 11:50 on Sunday morning, you're saying, whoo, preacher went a long time today. Listen, the coronavirus makes us get out earlier than ever before. They're not even full tables down at Cedar River Seafood yet. So you got plenty of time. You don't have to run out the door and get the first piece of flounder. You don't get any rewards in heaven for having the first piece. But what you ought to be doing is say, you know what? There's something to be excited about when it comes to eternal things. When it comes to Jesus. Man, we had chapel this week at school. Woo! We finished chapel on Wednesday. And these two little girls sitting over here, first year students in our school, they were sitting right here on Wednesday morning. Miss Crystal, Garrett came and talked to both of them, and both of them trusted Jesus as their Savior. Woo! That's worth having a school for right there. That's worth all the stuff you got to do just to see those two girls get saved. Get about 11 o'clock during the daytime. I'm sitting over at my office next door. Little knock on my door. Little timid Shiloh girl pushes open the door. It was the sister of those two girls that were sitting there during chapel. And she said, Brother Tim, you said if anybody ever needs to talk to you and pray with you to come see you. It looked like she was scared to death. I was wondering, what's she about to tell me? You know, is her house on fire and we need to go put out the fire? She looked at me and said, I'm not saved and I need to get saved. Woo! I mean to tell you, two sisters in chapel, one after chapel got saved. What I'm saying is if I can get excited about Fournay with a piece of leather under his arm coming in to the end zone, he gets in the end zone, he does his little dance and throws that ball down there, and you say, "Woo! my team scored. Hey, don't you know in heaven when somebody gets saved, there's excitement in heaven? And if you and I, as children of God, can't get excited about the things of God when God is blessing us, then something's wrong in our heart. Because to praise the Lord means to celebrate, to act the fool. Let me give you two or three examples of what I'm talking about. I didn't grow up being the person I am right now. My dad occasionally would talk about my shyness as a boy. If you'd have seen me at the age of 14 or 15, you'd have thought, that guy will never stand in front of even a crowd. Well, when I went to Bible college, I told you, Brother Matt, the other day, My One of my immediate friends I met in Bible school was a Filipino man. His name was Mandy Calanisan. And I was sitting in a missionary prayer meeting one afternoon at Trinity Baptist in McDuff in Jacksonville. And Mandy leaned over to me and introduced himself. I was shy and timid. He was probably 15 years older than me. He had gotten saved out of the U.S. Navy. Came to Jacksonville, was working over NAS Jax. And Alberto Gomez, a good preacher of the gospel in Colombia, a Colombian brother, witnessed to him on the machine line one day, and Mandy got saved. Well, Mandy started coming to church. I won't tell you the whole story about his life, but God wonderfully saved him, wonderfully saved his wife, two wonderful children, and when he graduated, went off to the Philippines and began to start churches. The finest soul winner I've ever personally known in my life was Mandy Calanisan. He died just a couple of years ago up in Canada in a tragedy, but was a preacher of the gospel all of his life. Mandy said to me one day, he said to me, "I want you to go street preaching with me." Now, street preaching, I'd never tried that before. I was about 19 years old at the time. He said, "I want you to go street preaching with me. It's just going to be me and maybe one or two others." So I jumped in his car after school one day. It's probably 1 o'clock in the afternoon on a Friday. And I went down to Hemming Plaza in Jacksonville. Y'all know where Hemming Plaza is at, by where the courthouse is at, where the courthouse, I guess, is at, and the bus station's not too far from there. And it's always been a little park where people would gather. And Mandy, Filipinos can play guitar, harmonica, accordion, piano, anything you want to play. He brought his accordion with him that day. And he said, "What we're going to do, Brother Tim, is," he said, "we're going to sing a song as people are coming to the bus stops. And then when we get finished singing, I want you to stand up on this bench over here and preach to the people." And my knees started going, "You want me to stand on the bench and preach to people?" "Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah." So we began to sing, "What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." And we sang 3 or 4 little songs. And then he said, "All right, go." I stood up on that bench about yay high. And I said, "The Bible says," and after that first word got out, it started coming, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten." People stopped and looked, who's that crazy nut standing on that bench over there shouting? I got through it. It was the most pitiful sermon. People probably felt sorry for me standing there. Mandy got back in the car with me on the way back, and he said this to me. I went with him many times during my Bible college years, but he said to me, "Brother Tim, I don't just stand on that bench and preach for the sake of the gospel. I do it for my humility." That stuck with me. I do it for my humility. I want to learn to be humble, and I do it for my humility. Now, fast forward. I'm about 35 years of age, maybe 38 years of age. I'm in Nigeria, West Africa, in a market full of Muslims. And I'm with a preacher, and he says, "We're going to preach to these people." I start preaching. I'm about 35, 38 years of age. And they couldn't see me. So the preacher says to me, "Stand up on this rock." I climb up on the rock with a megaphone using a translator for the Yoruba language. I look out about 100, 150 Muslim people standing around, and I preach the gospel to those people. You know, some of them got saved. But some of them probably thought, "What is that crazy guy doing standing on that rock in the middle of our market?" Fast forward just a little bit more. I'm about 41 years of age, and I'm in the largest city in West Africa, is Lagos, Nigeria. I'm in the largest market in Lagos, Nigeria, where they sell anything and everything fake you can want. I mean, Taiwan don't have them beat. There you can buy anything fake in what's called the Alaba Market. I begin to preach with my good friend Wale Orekan, Pastor Wale, and he says to me, "The people can't see you. Climb up on top of my bus." I think, "Lord, I'm going to fall off that bus." I start climbing up with my translator. I'm on top of a bus in the middle of hundreds of people, and they're stopping and listening to me while I preach the Word of God. I could tell you one story after another story after another story where I climbed up on top of something and preached Jesus. And you know what people did? Same thing you'd do if somebody stood out in our parking lot and did that. You say, "That guy's a nut." See, here's the issue. I'm not saying everybody has to have the same personality, but I am saying when you can get excited about a new piece of furniture and can't get excited about the gospel, something's wrong. Amen. When you can be more excited about getting a raise at your job than somebody staying out of hell, something's wrong. Our priorities in America have reversed of what they should be and used to be, and we've got to get back to a place where we're not afraid of old-time religion and being able to say that God that saved me and Jesus who died on the cross for me deserves my praise. And I'm to shine the light, draw attention to Him. I'm to boast about Him. Not just boast about your grandkid, boast about Jesus. Talk excessively about Him. Not just boast about Him, not just shine about Him, but celebrate Him. Act the fool for Him. He deserves to be praised. And if you're a child of God, may I say to you, as a most Americans probably here, swallow your pride. Forget who you are and what you look like. The reason that some of y'all, the Lord works in your heart the same way He does in mine, because the Holy Spirit lives in your heart. And the reason that you can't take a gospel track and pass it out to the guy next to you at the gas station is you're afraid of what he thinks about you. That's right. The reason that you can't talk to your maybe mother-in-law or stepmother or your father about the gospel at dinner table is because you're afraid of their rejection. May I remind you that when Jesus hung on the cross, He was despised and rejected. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Surely He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. I'm saying that the God of heaven that created everything was willing to humble Himself. Became obedient unto death. Even the death of the cross. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted Him and given Him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow. Of the things in heaven, the things in earth, and the things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. God loves people, but God's not going to reach the world for Christ until God's people decide to praise Him. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Would you bow your head for prayer, please? Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I wonder who this morning would say, Brother Tim, I've not been as open about my faith as I should have been. I've been a little bit ashamed to maybe speak about Him. I mean, I feel comfortable here at church, but maybe about around my lost family, my unsaved relatives, I get all stopped up and can't say nothing. And you'd say this morning, I want to be a better witness. Not just in the words I say in sharing the gospel, but the way I'm living. Maybe you haven't been a good witness because of your lifestyle. Maybe your kids don't ever hear you talk about the Lord even in your own house. Our children ought to grow up in a home where they hear us speaking about Jesus and celebrating Him. And shining attention on Him and boasting in Him. If you're here this morning as a child of God and you've taken a back seat to the world and got more excited about the things of this earth than you are about heaven and about eternal life and having your sins forgiven, God help us. God help us to be praising His name. Who would say, Brother Tim, pray for me this morning as a child? I know I'm saved. I'm a child of God. But I haven't praised Him in private, at home. I haven't praised Him in my prayer closet. I haven't praised Him in my car. I haven't praised Him at work like I should have. I haven't spoken of Him with my family like I should have. But starting this morning, I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to make a decision to start praising the Lord like He deserves. I'm going to do a better job at speaking of Him and talking about Him and glorifying Him. I'm going to magnify His name when I'm having opportunity. The Lord spoke to my heart. Would you do this? No one looking around. If the Lord spoke to your heart concerning some of these things, would you raise your hand and let me pray for you? Just let me pray for you. Slip it up and hold it there until I see it. God bless you and God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, I'm not trying to dictate what all you say to your mom or dad or uncle or what have you. I just want Jesus to be praised. And if we're praising Jesus like we should, I mean, when it's time to sing songs at Calvary Baptist Church, we ought to all be singing with vigor. We ought to be singing with delight. We ought to be singing out of joy. We ought not be bored during singing about heaven, singing about going to heaven and having our sins forgiven. It ought to be something that overflows from our heart. And maybe you're here today and you're not saved. I don't know your heart. I don't pretend to know what God's doing in your life. But if you're not saved, God loves you. Jesus died for you. If you're not born again this morning or not sure that you're saved, would you do this? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. If you're not certain that you're saved, would you let me pray for you in my closing prayer? You'd say, Brother Tim, pray for me. Here's my hand. I'm not 100% sure that if I died today, I'd go to heaven, but I'm concerned about my soul. Would you raise your hand and let me pray for you like that? I won't come to you or point you out by name or anything like that. I just want to pray for you. Brother Tim, pray for me. I'm not 100% sure I'm saved. I'm not 100% sure. I see that little hand over there. God bless you. Is there anybody else like that? Now let's all stand for prayer. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Please stand for prayer if you would. If God's dealt with your heart this morning, maybe about something completely unrelated to the Scriptures, the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. One of the reasons we have a public invitation for people to come and pray at the altar is not so we can get your name and sign you up for anything, but it's so that you can make an open decision about your faith and what you're deciding to do. You can make an open decision, even if it's to come pray about your family, you're making a public decision regarding that. Whatever your need is this morning, would you obey the Holy Spirit that lives within you? Would you obey the Holy Spirit of God and do what God wants you to do today? We're going to have others that are being talked to about different needs, salvation, baptism, other things. But maybe you just need to come and find a quiet place here at the front and let God have His way in your heart. Our Father, would you please help us to leave this place today with praise on our lips and in our hearts? Would you help us to take the focus off of us and ours and mine? And would we as Christians put the focus upon the Son of God? If I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me. Jesus, help us as a church collectively to lift up your name in this community. Help us individually in our homes to lift up your name. May it not be about religion or some ceremony or some edict of a church, but may it all, our love, our admiration, our praise, may it all revolve around the one that shed his blood on a cross for our souls. Help us to love you with a genuine sincerity, and may people around us see that and know that. Bless our invitation in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. As Brother Weaver begins to play for us, if God's dealt with your heart, would you step out and use this altar as an opportunity to pray? Maybe you're struggling with some sin in your life. God's dealing with your heart about that this morning. You can't really praise the Lord with your lips if your heart is far removed from Him. All you can say words, but the Lord sees the heart. It's not about shouting in church or simply having an amen when the preacher drops a certain line, but it's you from your heart having a spirit of praise. A genuine thankfulness for what the God of heaven has done and is doing in your heart and life. He inhabits the praise of His people. He dwells in the family where they'll praise Him. He resides at the address where we lift up His name. I want God to dwell at 1532 Long Bay. I want God to dwell in my home. If He's going to dwell, I've got to be ready to praise Him, to lift Him up. We're going to go back in a moment and sing that first stanza. If you know that song, Just As I Am, people are praying and being talked to here at the front. The Lord's dealing with your heart. You can come as we sing together, Just As I Am, on that first stanza.
Just as I am, out one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God.
Let's sing it again while people are still praying. Let God have his way in their hearts, just as I am.
Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
We can keep our heads bowed, our eyes closed. Brother Weaver, keep playing for us. You can have your seat there on the invitation. If you're tired and need to sit down, you can do that. I just want to give God plenty of time to work in the lives of people. If the Lord's dealing with your heart this morning and you've not yet made a decision, don't do what the preacher wants you to do. Do what Jesus wants you to do. Continue to play for us, Brother Weaver, if you will. Waiting for baptism this morning, you want to lead us in a song that we sing?
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we
rejoice to see that fountain in his
This is Aiden. Aiden has received Christ as his Lord and Savior. Aiden, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised to walk in newness of life. Bronson also received Christ as his Lord and Savior. Bronson, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen.
While we're waiting on those others to get baptized, let me just mention how God works. Deacons over here, Deacon. Just a second, Brother Dan. Deacon is over here, and Deacon's dad got saved here and baptized at our church in January of this year, and then 9 days later stepped into eternity in a tragedy in Jacksonville. And so Deacon's been coming to church faithfully since. And this morning, his cousin from Buffalo was with us, and he was that second young man that got baptized, and his name is Bronson. And Bronson's just visiting this weekend. So he comes to Florida from Buffalo with his cousin, and he gets saved and baptized here. And then here and back, I believe, is Philip, right? And Philip has been staying with Joe or Buddy and Sonny. And Philip has been saved, but this morning has never been baptized scripturally. So this morning he's getting baptized. And then Sonny's uncle will be baptized this morning to Joe before it's over, okay?
This is Philip. Philip also received Christ as his Lord and Savior. Philip, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, bearing the likeness of Christ's death. Praise to walk in newness of life. Joe also received Christ as his Lord and Savior. Joe, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ. Again. Praise to walk in the newness of life.
Exciting. I'm glad Daniel didn't lose him there for a second. I thought he was going to lose him. But 91 years of age. When you're 91 years of age, you get baptized like that, you deserve us to celebrate. We ought to all be celebrating. So thank the Lord for the service. Thank you for being here this morning. Make sure that you let our visitors know that we're grateful for their being here. And we're a church that tries to meet the spiritual needs of all of our community. If there's ever anything that we can do to help you in any way, I want you to reach out to us and let us know that, okay? Let's all stand for prayer. Announcements, choir at 5 o'clock. Choir at 5 o'clock here if you're part of the choir. And then evening service tonight, Brother Brent Gullah is going to be preaching for us. And then we'll have Brother Louis Brasino, the church planter to Miami, that's going to be here with us tonight, okay? Brother Weaver, you want to pray for us?
Lord Jesus, thank you for the opportunity to serve you. Thank you for the ones that were saved and baptized this morning. Help us to be grateful to you and always praise you for everything that you do. Lord, I pray you'll please go with us and bring us back at the appointed time. In Jesus' name, amen.